Good morning. I'm excited to be up here today because this lesson that I'm about to speak on is something that I find in some ways exciting to learn about. I actually learned this lesson back in 2011 at a Bible camp, and it was done by Jeff Smelser. And I actually came across an email where he sent me the material back in 2011, and I reached back out to him and got permission to speak on this. So don't give me any credit on this. This is all his material, his PowerPoint, his speaking points. But I figured instead of just playing a recording for you guys, I might as well learn it for myself and try to teach it on my own. But today, we'll be learning about the continuity in the Bible story and looking at how the Bible is one story. I'm not sure it's going forward. There we go. So yes, it's one story. It's not a random bunch of 66 stories or however many stories. There is Noah in the Ark. There is the virgin birth. There is Moses. There's a bunch of stories, and you know, sometimes it's easy to boil it down to maybe these are children's stories. And in fact, when I was talking to Chantel about this yesterday, I asked her, who are the patriarchs? And she pointed down to the dishwasher and said, they're the people on that magnet right there. So we've already gotten started on teaching, memorizing, things like that. But they're more than just stick figures on a magnet. They're actually people that had a role in bringing us to where we are now. So if you asked your friends who may not go to church, they may be able to tell you about Noah and the Ark, right? Or who Moses is and maybe what he did for the Egyptians. I actually did ask one of my friends, and he knew about Abraham sacrificing Isaac. But when I asked him about Noah and the, he actually didn't know the Ark. And so these stories that may be familiar to us, you know, they may hear about these stories, but not know where they go. And it may, to them, feel like, and to us, feel like isolated stories, but the Bible is one story, and I hope to prove that today. In addition, I would like to give a visual framework. And so I'll have a PowerPoint showing a timeline up there. And we're not going to cover the whole Bible. I thought about it after Josh and Craig talked about Jesus' life, but I'm going to give you a framework, and then maybe after this, you can, when you read these stories, you can fit them into different points. And then lastly, and probably most importantly, I want to show you the evidence for our faith. If you ask people today, they look at this as something that was written 2,000 years ago. It's out of touch. And really, if you ask Christians, or maybe asked me a week ago, you know, what's the point of reading the Old Testament when I read it and I have to discard half of it because it doesn't apply to us anymore, and we're under the new law now. I want to also show that God's handiwork is in this. It's not a bunch of random stories. I know we've probably read about things that may seem inexplicable, and we'll focus in on some of that, but there's stories in there that you say, where did that come from, and why is it that way? But what this really is God executing a plan throughout centuries, and we're now at this point as we look back. And there are a lot of prophecies, and we talk about prophecies a lot, and these are literal sentences, this will happen, this will happen. But there's also more than verbal prophecies. There's foreshadowing, there's parallels, and the word I'm using today is continuity and unity. When I think about continuity, just to give you guys what I'm thinking, continuity you see in the movies where the person's holding the glass and one shot it's halfway full, next shot it's completely full, next shot it's empty, next shot it's full again. That is a continuity error, right? And so when we read the Bible and we pick up this story, pick up this story, pick up this story, where do these all fit in together? In what order? And why is the order important? So I've got Luke 24:27 waiting up here for me. This is when Jesus has already been raised and he's on the road to Emmaus. And he catches those people that are studying, and they're pretty well-studied people from my guess. But it says, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Well, what we can take away from that is, even in the Old Testament, there are references to Jesus. There are things concerning Jesus. When we talk about Abraham, it's not just Abraham, but it's Abraham as it relates to Jesus. So, does anyone know who those people are? It's because they're not wearing clothes. We know it's Adam and Eve, right? So we'll start with Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve are God's first human creation. Things are pretty good. God says it's good. But when we get to chapter 3 of Genesis, sin is introduced. And things aren't so good. There's rebellion. There's sin. And because of that, they're driven out of the garden. This is our introduction to what sin does to our relationship with God. And this is where we can point back to where we should have concern for our souls. There's something eternal waiting for us. You should be concerned about that. When it was just the garden and just Adam and Eve, there wasn't that concern. But they became mortal, and so death is introduced into the picture. They did what they wanted and not what God asked, and God cannot abide with this. And so you think it stopped there, right? Well, as you go through generations or years or decades and decades, they are continually evil, and it says that specifically. They're continually evil, and so God has to wipe off the face of the earth, aside from Noah and his family. And so we have the flood, because sin has become rampant, and God brings destruction on the world. So this is where God makes a new plan. And we see 10 generations after Noah, him begin to implement that plan. So we have Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Three best friends, right? I might have thought that a week ago. So Isaac is actually Abraham's son, and Jacob is Isaac's son. This is a father, son, and grandson. When we learn about the Bible stories, they might run together a little bit, but this family becomes very important. And why are they important? From my understanding, they're fairly random people. But they become important because God makes promises to them. So please go ahead and turn to Genesis 12. Genesis 12, and we'll read a little bit about those promises. So look at verse 2. This is God talking to Abram. It says, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, so you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. So Jacob is also Israel, which is where we get Israelites. So we have the nation and land promise. Nation is in verse 2. I will make you a great nation. He's not saying, I'm going to make a great nation and give it to you, right? He's saying, from you will come a great nation. When you think nation, think nativity. Verse 5 says, Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his nephew, and all their possessions which they had accumulated, and the persons which they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan. Thus they came to the land of Canaan. And skip down to 7, the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land. So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. I will give you this land, the land of Canaan, the promised land, the land of flowing with milk and honey. This is where it first comes into the Bible. And this is actually where Isaac and Jacob, Israel, are born. They're born in Canaan. So Abram is told this and he immediately up and goes to Canaan. So we learn about the Israelites. What's it have to do with you and me? The rest of the Bible is them becoming a great nation. They end up in Egypt away from that land. They work their way through the wilderness to get back to the land. They fight to get the land. They fight to keep the land. And they end up losing the land anyway. They get kicked out of the land and live in a different land while wishing they go back to that land. And they finally get it back, which is the rest of the Old Testament. That sums up just roughly here, this much of the Bible. What does it have to do with you and me? Because this New Testament is what we live under, and that's the Old Testament. Well, verse 3 of Genesis 12. At the end, it says, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. All the families. That includes us. How are we going to be blessed through this? Well, he's referencing Jesus, who was sent on our behalf. Oh, there's Canaan. Right there. So the nation, land, and all families blessed points to Jesus. He was sent on our behalf because of our sin. And really, we talk about this story, that story, this story, that story. This is a full story that begins with the problem of sin and death and a solution, Jesus' death and resurrection. And everything in the middle is how we get to that point. And we're now living after the point of Jesus dying on the cross. So, sin and death, man becomes mortal and dies and has to be concerned for his soul. Jesus' death and resurrection, he takes away our sin, and he assures us that he has the power to raise us from the dead so we can overcome the consequence of sin. It's a big book, but it's one story. Problem, solution, it's one story, not 66 stories. And it's constantly anticipating the ending. But to summarize the rest of the Old Testament, Jacob has his 12 sons that you guys may have memorized, who then sell Joseph because he was the favorite. And through a series of events, the whole family reunites in Egypt and becomes slaves. In the beginning of Exodus, so they're sold into Egypt. In the beginning of Exodus, God uses Moses to bring the nation out of Egypt back to the promised land. Exodus is the way out of Egypt. So they're led by Moses to Mount Sinai, which is where we receive the Ten Commandments. And that's not to scale, if anyone's wondering. The old law is implemented during this time, and through it we learn about sacrifice, priesthood, and general law, general order. And after 40 years of wandering through the wilderness, they come up to Canaan and are led by Joshua across the Jordan River. So they begin in Egypt. That's around where Mount Sinai is projected. And they go up through the land for 40 years. And eventually they come up to the Jordan River, which is right outside Canaan. And they're led by Joshua into Canaan, and they have to fight to get it back. And so when they get back to Canaan, they're given kings like King Saul and then King David. And David's told his throne will be established forever, which foreshadows a spiritual kingdom. And so people begin looking for a descendant of David from the tribe of Judah. They then have King Solomon, who builds the temple in Jerusalem. However, he sins, and because of his sin, the kingdoms are divided and become Israel and the largest tribe, Judah. And both kingdoms worship idols, so God allows them to be defeated and placed in captivity. And they hope for decades to get back into the land, which they do end up getting, but they do not get kings again. During this time, prophets continue to tell people, God will keep his word, and the anointed Messiah is coming. He'll bring salvation and restoration, and that's the end of the Old Testament. And the New Testament begins with Jesus coming, and he is a blessing for all of the earth. So all of these anticipate Jesus. They may seem inexplicable at times, but they are concepts, and they lay the foundation of holiness and the disaster of sin. So the New Testament's around 100 years. So the Bible is creation through about 70 years after Jesus' death. And without seeing how it points to Jesus, that's all you're going to see. The Old Testament's about the Israelites getting and losing it until they are back. And the question becomes, why is this collection of books about a different people and land in another part of the world relevant to us? It's because they all build towards Jesus, who is our atoning sacrifice for the sins of mankind. So I actually have about 5 PowerPoints worth of foreshadowing material. I'm only going to use 3 or 4 of these to demonstrate, depending on time. That first one is Abraham and Isaac in Genesis 22. Go ahead and turn to Genesis 22. So the promises made to Abraham about the promises. And in different parts of Genesis, the promises are repeated to Isaac and Jacob. So Abraham already knows that through Isaac, the nations will be blessed. But then in Genesis 22, he's told to sacrifice Isaac. So let's read, starting in verse 1. I believe I have it up here. There we go. So that's Genesis 22, starting verse 1. I'm reading New American Standard. I believe that's New King James. Now it came about after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. He said, Take now your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and he split wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham raised his eyes and saw the place from a distance. On the third day. So he's been traveling for 3 days to this place. Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey, and I and the lad will go over to you. And we will worship and return to you. And in the literal text, it says, we will worship and plural return to you. You may be asking yourself, how is this so? Is he trying to trick Isaac? Will he tell him when he gets there? Well, we'll see. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked together. Isaac spoke to Abraham his father and said, My father. And he said, Here I am, my son. And he said, Behold the fire and the wood, but where's the lamb and the burnt offering? Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. So we'll pause there. I want to key in a little bit on the distance. So he's told to go to this mountain. In our eyes, a random mountain. That's 3 days' journey. And then he brings up, we will return. We will return when he knows that he will be sacrificing Isaac when he's up there. Another thing I'd like to key in on is it says in verse 2, the beginning, take your son, your only son. You guys know that Isaac is not his only son. And in fact, in the previous chapter, it talks about Ishmael. And then in Genesis 17, you can turn there if you want, or you can take my word for it. When he is told about these promises, Abraham thinks that God is talking about Ishmael. But God says, I will take care of Ishmael, but who I'm talking about is Isaac, your son. So specifically, God tells him that the promise will come through Isaac. And then he tells him, sacrifice him. Why would God be doing this to him? He's told, do this. No, actually kill him. And then as we'll read, actually I'm going to save him. So just to summarize the next few verses, Abraham does put Isaac on the altar. He raises his hand to slay him. And then an angel tells him to stop. And he looks up and sees a ram caught in the thicket, and uses that ram instead as the sacrifice, and Isaac is spared. So he's told one thing, and another thing, and then another thing. Why? What's the point? It seems inexplicable when you're just reading the story. It seems like God is just seeing what he'll do, almost like playing with him. But when you look at this through the perspective of how it points to Jesus, things become abundantly more clear. And I understand that there are lessons to learn from this about faith and testing and trusting God. But we're looking at the perspective of how it relates to Jesus. The first one, and probably the clearest upon reading it, is the concept of the only son. It's said in the New Testament about the only begotten son, and I believe in the New King James, it does say begotten. That's the same language. And considering he has two sons that he both loves, he loves both of them, the language starts to not really make sense unless it points to one certain thing. The other piece is the distance. Go to Mount Moriah. Mount Moriah. Does that mean anything to you guys? Well, actually, it comes up one other time in the entire Bible. I believe I put that scripture there. It's when Solomon is building the temple, God's permanent home, past the tabernacle. It says, Now Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem on Mount Moriah. That's the only mention. But notice, at Jerusalem. Jerusalem has a lot of significance in the Bible. And one of the most significant parts of it is that is where Jesus was crucified. He was at the Mount of Golgotha, also known as Calvary, right outside of Jerusalem. So he's taken his only begotten son to the mountain in Jerusalem to sacrifice his only son. There's some pretty glaring parallels here. And there are other things that point to the sacrifice. Verse 6 says, Abraham took the wood and laid it on Isaac his son. You guys might remember that Jesus carried his cross, not unlike Isaac carrying the wood to his own sacrifice. And then we talk about, you can say, if you don't necessarily have the same understanding through the years of reading the Bible, you may say, well, he didn't lose his son. He didn't sacrifice him. And so, you know, maybe I'm kind of trying to finesse this and make things that aren't there. But in the Hebrews verse, if you go back, Hebrews 11, 17 through 19 says, by faith Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, in Isaac your seed shall be called, concluding that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from which he also received him in a figurative sense. For all intents and purposes, Isaac was sacrificed. When you raise your hand to slay your child, you're not going back from that. And so the relief that Abraham had was the same relief as having his child or losing his child and him coming back. In a figurative sense, he did lose his child. Those aren't my words. Those are from Hebrews. But the biggest takeaway from this is that God provided the lamb for sacrifice. And as I summarized, and go back forward to the rest of it. Go back one. I don't know if that's me. There we go. So, as I summarized for you, the ram was provided for the sacrifice. And so in this literal story, a lamb was provided for Abraham in Isaac's place. You can compare that to Jesus being the lamb who takes our place for sacrifice. And so what this story really boils down to, yes, it's a test of faith, but to me, what it really boils down to is that the Lord will provide the sacrifice. And so maybe there was some finessing there, maybe there was some stretching, maybe it was just a story of testing faith. But like I said, there are so many examples in the Bible that point to this. So go ahead to Jacob, and you can pause. Actually, go forward two or three. One more. So in Genesis 28, you can go ahead and turn there, but I have it listed there. Genesis 28:10, this is after Jacob is sent away for lying to Isaac. While he was out wandering, verse 10, Jacob departed from Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and spent the night there, because the sun had set, and he took one of the stones of the place and put it under his head and lay down in that place. He had a dream, and behold, a ladder was set on earth, and its top reaching to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. So, there are a lot of stories in the Bible. Good storytelling, I think we would all agree. Why in the world would we want to hear about someone's dream when we have all these happenings throughout the years? I had a dream last night. Would you guys like to hear about it? No? Okay. I don't want to hear about yours either. But Jacob had a pretty important dream when you look at it from the perspective of Jesus. And so, go ahead one. In John 1 and 51, this is Jesus talking to the Jews. And the Jews are well studied, right? They know the stories of the Old Testament already. They learn about them, they teach them. And so, Jesus says to them, most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter ye shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the ladder. Think they could fill in the blanks there? They've read this story. Let's see if I can go ahead. The Son of Man. Jesus is referred to this as the Son of Man many times throughout the Bible. And in this story, or in this instance, he takes the place of the ladder. So what does the ladder represent? Well, we talked about how sin separated God and man. Jesus is coming to reconnect God and man. And so the ascending and descending, it illustrates a relationship. You could say prayer, but let's just say relationship. Jesus came to restore that. So all of a sudden, this dream takes on a little more meaning than Jacob's dream. And then when you read further, the promise is repeated back to him. Now, I did ask Teddy to lead that second song, Near My God to Thee, because it says, though like a wanderer, the sun gone down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone. And then in my dreams, I be near my God to thee. The writer of that song is referencing this scripture, and he understands the point of it, near my God to thee. He understands that through that story, it's illustrating our closeness with God, which is the prayer and the strengthened relationship, or the renewed relationship. So once again, we have to look through these things as problem and solution. These things in the Old Testament are pointing to Jesus, or referencing, or foreshadowing. Okay, so now, let's look at another illustration, Exodus 11. Exodus 11, I'm sure you guys are pretty familiar with the plagues. This is talking about the last plague. So the plagues were used to show God's power and in hopes of convincing Pharaoh to let the Israelites go from Egypt. Well, every time the plagues end, Pharaoh changes his mind. And so this is the final plague that finally does the trick, basically. And that's that the death of the Egyptian firstborn. And so, actually, let's go ahead to chapter 12, and it shows how this is accomplished. So, verse 3 of chapter 12. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, they are each to take one lamb for themselves, according to the father's households, a lamb for each household. And skip to verse 6. You shall keep it until the 14th day, and then kill it at twilight. And then in verse 7, moreover, they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses in which they eat at, or they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that same night, roasted with fire, and they shall eat it with unleavened bread, notice that, and bitter herbs. And then skip to verse 11, you shall eat it in this manner, with your loins girded and your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. This is where the Passover is implemented. So, this is one of those inexplicable things. God would like them to slay a lamb and smear its blood on the doorpost so that he knows which house is Egyptian and which house is Israelite. Well, if you're a skeptic, or skeptical, or being difficult, you could say that, why didn't God just use his infinite wisdom? Why not just slay the Egyptians? Why does he need them to do this? Well, what you could boil this down to as the first instance of people being saved by the blood of the Lamb. And this is the implementation of the Passover. You guys remember that Jesus had a final meal, and it's referred to as the Last Supper by a lot of people. The meal he was actually eating was the Passover meal. And the unleavened bread, there's a lot of things that tie together that show that Jesus took the place of this. He became the Passover meal. So is this a children's story, 10 plagues, easy to talk about? Yes. But it's also another story that points to and prepares the minds of the people for Jesus' coming. As we talked about in the gospel meeting a few weeks ago, we talked about how it's not that God is one God in the Old Testament and one in the New. It's about the people being different and God presenting himself in different ways to those people as they're ready And there's a Bible verse in the New Testament that says, at the right time, Jesus was sent. It's not the right time in Exodus. The people are not ready. They don't have the same understanding that they will hundreds of years later. So this is instruction. And are they thinking, oh, this will prepare us for Jesus? No. But they're understanding the instruction and learning how to receive instruction that also points to Jesus. So don't take my word for it that Jesus is our Passover lamb. Look at that second one, 1 Corinthians 5:7. Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Jesus Christ is our Passover. Those are not my words. Those are from the Bible. And in John 1:29, Jesus is referred to by John the Baptist as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And so Jesus is our Lamb who takes away our sin. We learn in the Old Testament about the blood of the Lamb saving men from death. So, let's see. I will run through the last one, which is the tabernacle. Yes. So go ahead and bring that all up. So the tabernacle itself symbolizes salvation. So we have the bronze altar. When you first walk up to it, that is where sacrifices are made. You cannot have atonement without sacrifice. And then there's the laver, or the basin of water, which represents baptism. Once you walk inside, which we wouldn't be able to walk inside at that time, you have the table of showbread, the bread of life. The bread of life. And then, getting ahead of my notes here. Then you have the lampstand. And then that one thing right there is the incense. How'd I write it? Well, the incense represents, oh, there it is. The altar of incense, it represents prayers. Prayers are described as a sweet and smelling and savory smell to God. What better way to represent it than an altar of incense? And it is right next to the veil, and the veil separates the ark, which is the mercy seat of, it contains the mercy seat of God. Until Jesus came, the veil separated that communication with God from the people. Only one person could go in there, and that was the high priest one day a year. Well, I'm not sure if I put it in the PowerPoint. When Jesus was slain, it is said that the veil was torn in two. Matthew 27:50. Just in case I don't have it, turn there. Matthew 27:50. I'll go ahead and read. Matthew 27:50, and Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and rocks were split. It's easy to read over that, but that has a lot of semblance if you have read through the Old Testament with Jesus coming in mind. The veil was torn in two. Some people project it to be 30 feet tall, 3 inches thick, and it just ripped down the middle. When Jesus died, that veil was torn, thus opening up communication with God in a different way than the Old Testament. So when people were making the tabernacle, they didn't see it as a prediction of 1,400 years from now, this will all change. They saw it as an instruction, and we won't read it, but in Hebrews 9, it talks about why there was a specific and strict pattern that had to be made. This wasn't just set up a tent and throw some things in there. The pattern represents salvation, sacrifice, baptism, bread of life as we continue after baptism, and then a relationship with God. That's what it represents. So skip ahead. There we go. So the Bible has 40 writers, some Jews, some not, so different nationalities, and it was written over 1,500 years. This wasn't people getting together and saying, hey, let's write this book. And so for this many writers over this many years to write a cohesive story where there's a unified beginning and unified ending, and throughout all of the book, the ending is referenced, That takes forethought and design. If I asked 40 of you to write a story and I gave you a topic to write about right now, you think it would get published? Probably not. And not only would it not be as cohesive, even though you guys are all in the same room at the same time, this book that we read does have cohesion, and it has forethought. You compare it to a novel where maybe you read a tiny detail, and you read over it, and then by the end, by chapter 26, that detail becomes pretty important. That's because the writer was writing with the end in mind. When he started in chapter 1, he knew what that ending was going to be, and it's no different than this book. So just as conclusion, I'd like to just kind of circle back to the importance of this. Without continuity and without context, these are all a bunch of random stories. And it's 3/4 of a book that we hold very valuable that in some ways could be viewed as obsolete. But when we understand why these stories were in there, it becomes meaningful and it gives us a new perspective and in a lot of ways the right perspective to read these stories, that the end is in mind. And it points to how Jesus is the culmination of all of this. Yes, it was happening to these people, but it was happening because Jesus was coming. So for me to study this, it's been, you know, it has been life-changing. And I'd encourage you guys to do the same thing. If you would like a recording, actually I have like 4 recordings of these things. I would be more than happy to get it to you. I think it'd be good to listen to it multiple times. But it gives a new way to study this. And another reason I find it very important is because God did the background work. He did the behind the scenes, knowing that it was preparing us for the most important thing, which was Jesus' sacrifice for us. But he does require something from us. He requires us to read it for understanding. And I would say that if you have doubts about the Bible, God has done so much work that it leaves us with no excuse but to seek to understand it for ourselves. And so if you are hearing this and you had the understanding that I had a week ago, I'm glad you're here today, because I hope this opens the door for you to go back and study this for yourself and continue to add stories. There's a lot of time that's not been covered there. How do these stories fit into Jesus? And there's a lot of moral questions and right and wrong questions that we're faced with today. And if we're quoting a 2,000-year-old book without the understanding of why we should be quoting this 2,000-year-old book, it's going to leave us without a lot of power, basically. So this will give us power, understanding, and hopefully a renewed energy to share these things with others, because we know that when we read the Bible, we can yield understanding from the entire Bible. And it's not just right and wrong, do this, don't do this, but there's a story being told at the same time. So, the sacrifice has been provided for you. And if you feel like there's something you need to do, I hope you take care of it now. And thank you for your attention.